Philippines is currently aiming to be the world's number one experience hub for information technology and business process management. While we remain the business process outsourcing hub of Asia, we've lagged behind in terms of offshore rankings.
To tell us more about how we're trying to recover, we have the Managing Director of the Contact Center Association of the Philippines, Rosario Cahucom Bradbury. CCAP is one of our country's major players in the BPO industry. And earlier before the show, we were trying to look at the numbers of how big this industry is now. Because I remember 20 years ago, it was a baby industry.
Correct, yes.
Now it's at 32, you say it's 32.5 billion in terms of revenues, the entire industry.
Correct.
And your roadmap wants you to double that in 6 years.
Exactly. So you see the 20 years achievement of the IT BPM industry is going to double in 6 years. Let's put it in number. So in 2022 was $32.5 billion revenue. Dollar. And we had 1.57 full-time employees working in the IT BPM industry. So in 2028, the target is to become $59 billion revenue. So almost doubling it in 6 years, that was achieved in 20 years. And 1.57 million full-time employees, so Filipinos, is going to become 2.5, so an additional 1.1 million
in 6 years
as well. But you have to understand the 1.57 is the direct employees. Mm-hmm. There is an indirect jobs creation out of that. They say there's a multiplying factor of 3 to 5, which is, you know, vendors and service providers are created. So yeah. you create more jobs. But some people are saying, no, the multiplying factor is 7 to 8, Rosario, not just 3 or 4. So the point is the IT BPM industry or the BPO and CCAP, one of the associations, is a major job generator.
Yeah.
And I think what's very important to understand this is a inclusive impact to the society. The intent is to grow it in the countryside. Because mm-hmm. right now, 70% of the workforce are in Metro Manila, mm-hmm. and 30% are in the province. So the intent of the 2028 roadmap is to achieve minimum 40% in the countryside, and then 60% maximum in Metro Manila, so that then there is an inclusive growth.
Yeah.
But how do you achieve that? That's the question, you know? So we work with DICT, and DICT has digital cities of the 31 digital cities, the LGUs.
Mm-hmm.
So they are being coached or helped by DICT to become really digitally enabled to be able that we could do the IT BPM hub in these areas. So these are the 31 digital cities. And we made survey with our members, and a lot of them are really considering going to the provincial areas.
I think that makes sense because you're actually offshored here, so it's not a problem to offshore
to other provinces,
yeah. Right?
Exactly.
And the multiplier effect will also grow in those areas,
exactly.
Further maybe reducing the complexity of business operations here in Metro Manila.
Yeah, decongesting it, I think.
It as well.
And I think the pandemic has proven that you can do work from anywhere.
Yeah.
But to be able to do that from anywhere, you have to be cognizant of the four areas to make it happen.
Mm-hmm.
And I think one is the ease of doing business. So every LGUs, as you know, have different processes, but of course with a master government regulations, but each of the LGU have different processes. So the ease of doing business, and of course the incentive in investing more mm-hmm. into the country. The other one is the infrastructure.
Mm-hmm.
So the infrastructure of the telecom, the connectivity. Sometimes it's just in the main city of that province where there is good connectivity, mm-hmm. but it's a work from home. What if that person is working from home, which is in the outskirts of that particular digital city? Is there infrastructure development there already?
Mm-hmm.
So those are the key issues, and the road and the real estate. Have they really also adopted mm-hmm. into this hybrid work model? And the third one, which is very critical, is the talent development. The growth in 6 years, the question is, do we have the talents to be able to supply this demand?
Right, we were going to ask that as well, because in the past we've been talking to different people about the job skills mismatch.
Well, yesterday, Lisa also
right, exactly.
About that.
Is that a big factor in the IT BPM industry as well?
It is a major factor. That's why a lot of our efforts are really concentrated into terms of talent development. So we've been discussing with academe Aside from the academe, let me park that academe first. There's a discussion with the DepEd and CHED for K-12 and the college educations and TESDA for micro-credentials. There is a need to really enhance the curriculum, that an input from the industry is considered so that then the workability or the workforce coming from the college students are really employable, okay? So that's happening discussion at the moment. So other initiatives happening is we partner as an association to various academe, like the Asia Pacific College, the Mapua Malaya Digital, the National University, and PUP. What are we doing? There's another fourth level, which I failed to mention after the talent development, which is marketing. The marketing is to the country and marketing within our country, career marketing. So we go to these universities to tell them ITBPM industry is a choice career that you should consider.
Because you were saying earlier there's still a stigma. I couldn't believe it. I mean, people think, right? You go to BPO centers or you become a call center agent. You earn a lot of money, but apparently they still don't think that that's a good option.
And you usually still hear that that comment, BPO,
BPO,
call center. I couldn't believe it at first.
That's true. I mean, there's still a stigma. Maybe it's not as bad as before, but the pandemic has shown that this is the most resilient industry and that they realize this has fueled the consumers of spending. You know, so medyo nag-go open, but it is not enough just because of the experience, because after that people forget it already. Oh, we're not in the crisis anymore,
crisis mode,
so we could go into these things. So we need to do a lot of education in the academe into the education. But there's other initiative on talent development, upskilling and reskilling are being done by the private sector. So as we try to develop upskilling and reskilling in our current workforce, this is our current workforce. We need to think of the incoming workforce. Hence the discussion with the academe and with the government agencies.
I was very curious because when you say upskilling, reskilling, or making sure that the high school students now can be immediately employed, they don't have to go to college, apparently. What are the things that you really need from them? It's not about talking on the phone or accent or grammar, right? It's not that. It's not even coding.
Yeah, you can train them in how to speak and accent and things like that. There's so many tools to help, and we invest a lot in the training of that. But what are the critical skills that are missing right now is the critical thinking. Okay, so as far as soft skills are concerned, this is very important, the critical thinking, anticipative of when you talk to a client, how could you anticipate straight away on how to resolve this issue and things like that. Where generative AI comes in at some point, because they are able, the generative AI is able to aid the call agents on how to answer the call more expeditiously and productively. By doing that, you become more active listening and your empathy comes out even more. So on that basis, the customer experience is enhanced, as well as the employee experience is enhanced.
But you can't be a robot there.
But
you cannot
still
have to think.
Yeah. Exactly. So that's why the generative AI is just assisting in that aspect. Now, the other skills missing to answer your question is that with the generative AI coming in, there's an importance to be able to educate the incoming workforce and the current on data science, okay? And you, the generative AI coming in, it doesn't mean that our people are not prepared of that, but also the client have to be prepared to adopt the generative AI. So to anticipate that we're already upskilling the people to be able to handle complex questions, because the generative AI will assist you on basic ones. Now, how do you use your critical thinking now to be able to handle complex questions. So that's where the soft skills comes in. That's where a lot of upskilling and reskilling. But we have to move very fast, because sometimes after you train them, it's too late, there's a new one coming in.
And they leave. They leave so fast.
I know, so it's like a vicious circle. So you upskill, reskill in the private sector, you must make sure the incoming talents are really as near as par, if possible, so that din naman ang investment mo in upskilling, reskilling, hindi vicious circle, pareho ng pareho ng pareho.
No? I have another question. How is the ITBPM industry here in the country looking at competition? And that's something we brought up in our introduction, because in the recent ranking of the Global Services Location Index, the Philippines actually dropped about 3 places down from its rankings. And it's talking about the rise of Mexico and Colombia. But what how are we faring now against maybe I guess first our Asian neighbors and other countries, but what are they doing right to go up in those rankings and why are we slipping?
Okay, first of all, let's put the big landscape of the market. The global market is about $275 billion revenue to $300 billion revenue. So that's the global market for which all of us are sharing, okay? So, and we ended at 32.5 in 2022. So the net of 32.5 to the 275 billion is really big that is shared by these companies. So put the eye on the ball. Do not forget the target to double it in 2028. Now, I'd like to comment on that ranking, okay? In the BPO industry, there is an offshoring, nearshoring, onshoring.
Yes.
Okay?
And this talks about offshore.
Correct, yes. Offshore, but there's a nearshoring that it is near your country.
Yes.
Okay, or in another state, in the United States. And the majority of our client globally is the North America. Of course, a portion of the Europe plus UK and Asia with Australia and things like that. You speak of Colombia and Mexico as a competition, okay, right? In that aspect, I will put my hat when I used to run a BPO, which is servicing the global, okay? We competed with Latin American country versus Philippines. Where will they put the BPO? So they put it in the Philippines majority and some in Chile, okay? Now, but they put some in Chile because of the language capability of the intricacies of Latin language, okay? That we said in the Philippines, we know Spanish, but we probably don't know too much of the intricacies of business of Colombia, Bolivia, Ecuador, Chile, and so forth, for which this near shore understands better.
Yeah.
And it's almost the same time zone. So we said, you pick the market. I can handle the general Spanish from Spain, but you can handle that area. But I will then attack the market from Europe, because I have a lot of people that can understand and speak French for our Francophone contracts, and in Asia to speak Taiwanese, Potongtuan, Mandarin, and all of that, and Japanese, I can find it in the Philippines. So you pick your market, there's such a big market. So I would understand probably that suddenly they're raising. It is probably a sign that we should not ignore and not be sitting on our laurels or being complacent.
Right.
But if you also put a context that probably they suddenly woke up that this industry is something to generate for their GDP. Because if I put a comparison of GDP contribution, Philippines depend on this economy of 8% minimum to 10% by 2028 GDP. This countries that we're competing with is 1.3, 2.5, 3% of their GDP. So when we saw that, as it shows that our business, how do you call this, a drive should really be more there because it's 8 to 10%, and they're 1.3, 3.4, and they saw we're big. So they're probably waking up. This is something they should also, and they saw it was resilient during pandemic. They should play in the game. They either late in the game, they're trying to catch up, or they're capitalizing on the nearshore of the language and the same time zone. So I would look at it that way.
If you're going to double it in the next 6 years, then will you be able to go back up in the rankings?
Yes, definitely. First of all, it's 32.5 in 2022. The $59 billion revenue is even a conservative target versus a $275 billion revenue market.
Quick question before we end. There are a lot of things to talk about. Cyber crime, cyber security is also a concern in your industry. Just very quickly, and you have an upcoming event about this. How is it? Are you scared? Are you scared about all of the cyber crime, all of the new developments in this field that can hurt the ITBPM sector?
Technology has always been a partner of the ITBPM industry, being called an information technology, business process and management. And we've gone through many technological advancements, and cyber crime has been there historically. But it has accelerated because of the digitization even more. So you have to be more anticipative. Yes, it is a threat, but it doesn't mean it will eat us now. So we better act on it
now.
Yeah. Now, it is not only a threat to this industry, but it is the threat to the world. It is a threat to the Philippines. It is a threat to the various industry sectors. So what are we doing in the ITBPM industry in that area? In SICA, which is the Contact Center Association mm-hmm. of the Philippines, 85% of the total volume of the Philippines, we have developed a program called One Trust Link. Mm-hmm. And this One Trust Link will be featured in our forum on the September 12th, which is called the Digital Trust 2023, which is strengthening fraud, fight against fraud, elevating business continuity plan, and enhancing cybersecurity. Now, fraud is something we need to nip in the bud as early as possible. Mm-hmm. So the program One Trust Link is a collaboration of all of the BPO industry in the CCAP by putting it into a database with compliance to data privacy mm-hmm. of those employees that had fraudulent cases.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. For that matter.
So you don't hire them anymore because the risk is within. Actually.
Correct. I wouldn't say you don't hire it anymore, but it raises just a flag mm-hmm. as a first background check. And then it's depend on you and whether you will want to go to a further due diligence mm-hmm. check. So this conference is going to showcase that. Mm-hmm. And this conference is also to showcase the resiliency of the industry. The new things that you should think and elevate on business continuity plan with a COVID, mm-hmm. you never thought that this type of business disruption was going to happen. The volcanic eruption
right.
and things like that.
Rosario,
and the technology.
Thank you very much. I hope you come back. We have so many more things to talk about.
I know. Sorry, I've been so talkative, so just passionate about it.
I love it.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.